The backstory to this is I went to the Silver Lake Film Festival. And while I was there, I had seen the film you're going to see tonight, the Anna Cabrini Chronicles by Tawd, Dorenfeld. And I was just totally blown away by it. And I got a chance to talk to Tawd for a while after the show. And I said, it would be really great if you came and showed it at my school that I work at. Because, you know, we have a lot of people come in here and talk, and we have a lot of amazing people come, but I always felt like we don't have enough, like, sort of edgier things or things that are outside of the box, you know? It seems like a lot of the stuff we have coming in is very, you know, very industry and sort of on the corporate side and very, you know what I mean? And so I was thinking, I'd really like to expose you guys to stuff that you wouldn't normally see. And that's sort of the inspiration for this. And besides just being generally blown away by the filmmaking. And the other thing I really liked about it is that, you know, here's pretty much, you know, a guy who made a film, you know, by himself with a small crew of over 6 years of like hard work and passion. And just the idea that, you know, you could do something like that too if you had that kind of intensity and focus and passion on a specific idea. So I was really impressed by that too, and hoping that might inspire you. So anyways, let's bring Tawd up here to do a few introductory remarks. Tawd?
Actually, I never tried to commit suicide.
I didn't want to be a freak.
Oh, he's taller than me. So he's right, yeah, I spent 6 years making the film, and a lot of stories you hear in the industry is people go, oh, well, you know, we spent 8 years making this movie, and the reality was that they spent 6 to 7 of those years raising money, and then about a year making the movie. We did not do that. We started 6 years in the very beginning, and we spent 6 years making the movie.
Half my life, I'm over it.
It's a very serious film. It's probably going to send your brains through a blender tonight, and on a very, very, very intense level. After the first story, some of you may want to walk out and leave, but trust me, you're gonna. If you do, just breathe out there, come back in, and deal with the rest of the film. Because you'll appreciate that you came back in. Last year, I called movie theaters on my own accord and sent them the film all the way up the West Coast. And the theaters booked the movie based on its merit, which was really impressive to me and my small little crew of people that had worked on the film. So we did a tour, and why I say this about walking out is because the one thing that I learned was that if I didn't run out of the theater after the first story, I might lose 10 to 15 people in my audience. So after the first two screenings, I started leaving and waiting for them and having discussions outside on the street, and then these people would go back into the movie because nobody wanted to leave, they just wanted to breathe.
So really?
With long hair, yeah, walked out of the film.
Kiss my ass. That was a good movie. I've seen that movie 3 times already, and it was amazing. Like,
so do you own it?
Yeah, I own it. I own the fucking movie.
So, as a warning, that's it. And you're gonna have a lot of questions probably after the film. It generally does that. And we're also brought some DVDs for sale, so you guys can pick up a copy afterwards. So we'll do a Q&A. So, do your best to enjoy the Anna Cabrini Chronicles.
You came to me like an angel of truth.
Are you happy now?
Okay, don't worry about it. Thank you, and especially thank you to Andrew for sending this up for all of us. So, yeah, thank you, Andrew. And we'll just open it up for questions. Wait, Mommy. You.
How much of this was inspired by actual events?
It is all actors, and they're all doing stories that I wrote, but about, you could say, 80%, 85% of the film is based on experiences I've had in my own life with people that I've been extremely intimate with, or family members, or extremely close friends. So I'm not making this stuff up, I'm putting it together.
I couldn't wait until I'd be old enough to study every aspect of it. I set out to chronicle the lives of those deemed depressed, crazy, suicidal.
But a lot of the people didn't act a day in their life prior to the film, and some did. Brian Trujillo plays Merrick.
Get a divorce! Fuck! I don't care! Just do something! Fuck!
Never even thought of being an actor until I met him on Venice Beach and had him come in for a small audition, and he just ate it up, and we said, well, you're gonna learn how to act now.
Fucker.
Yeah, he was 12 when he did that.
Yeah. What kind of cameras were you using?
Oh, okay.
And how? And what were your, why'd you make those choices stylistically?
Sure. Our main camera is the Bolex, 16mm, with a motor on it, so that I can change the speeds of the film. And then what we're also shooting on is mini DV with GL1s and XL1s.
Brown ass bitch! You fucking white class Montana Avenue, yuffie star, fucking blah 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 blah!
You piece of shit, get the fuck out of here!
And then we're also shooting on a lot of Super 8.
I tried to commit suicide.
And the reasoning for doing everything in this particular style is, when I set out to make this picture, I said, I got no money. So, but I have a whole monologue film.
And noted as losers of a mindless generation that could care less about saving the world.
And I got more lines of dialogue in this film than you get in three films put together. So I said, well, I'm not going to be able to afford to keep reshooting film stock over and over every time someone flubs a line or whatnot. You know, my ratio would be 2-1. So I needed to get a bigger ratio than that, but I had no money. So I said, well, because it's a monologue film and because it's going to be presented in a form of flashback storytelling and collage work, I can do all of my actual dialogue stuff on mini DV.
Alright, just,
that's how drugs are supposed to work? But they never worked, because they weren't there to... They weren't there to fix the scrambling thoughts and ideas. The medication was there to fix my back pain.